Morning. Good morning. Let's all stand and worship. Come. Now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Now is the time to worship. Come. Now is the time to give your heart. Come. Just as you are to worship. Come. Just as you are before your God. Come. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come.
Welcome. If you're visiting with us, and there's definitely a few, it's great to have you here. I think most of you that are visiting are here for a baptism, and that's great. You'll notice that I'm not in a suit this morning. Some of you are happy about that. I'm sad. But I didn't feel like going in the water in a suit, and then we had a visitor show up in a three-piece, and I really felt bad. So that's okay. It's great to be together. And whether you're visiting, you're new, or you've been here for a long time, I'm happy to see you this morning. There's an open house today. April and I have invited the church to come and to celebrate our house and to spend time together as a church. So that's from 2 to 4 p.m. today. If you need our address, you can get a hold of us, or it went out in the bulletin email this week. There's a fellowship time and coffee downstairs following the service. So I would encourage you to go downstairs to interact with one another, maybe to introduce yourself to someone you don't know, and have some coffee. There's probably some cookies. You know, things get busy in life, and it's easy to go to the next thing, to move on to the next task. And I would just encourage you and challenge you to prioritize getting together and spending time with other believers. Last week, I said that there was a guy with medical conditions in need of firewood, and a few couples from the church contacted me and said that they wanted to go, and one of the couples has dropped off wood so far, and they are so appreciative. They couldn't believe that they left a voicemail at some random church and that people showed up with cut firewood for strangers. They just didn't understand why somebody would do that. And they are so thankful. So thank you. And to the couples who are still hoping to do that, thank you as well. Next week, September 4th, there's a special service to honor and commission everyone involved with the education and care of children. We are going to have a message directed towards that and be praying for you as you start this next school year. So please come for that. There's going to be a potluck lunch after the service. So if you're able, bring food. If you're able to, bring lots of food. And if you're not able to bring food, just bring yourself. It'd be great to have you there for that as well. There's a poster and a video for that on Facebook, so you can like and share that so that other people will see it. And I have asked Caleb to come up this morning and to read our call to worship. It's found in Psalm 119, verses 9 through 16.
How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word, I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. I have hidden in your word in my heart, that I might not sin against you. Praise be to you, Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you that we can be gathered here, that you've called us together with one another to praise you and worship you and sing of your greatness and your goodness, Lord. I pray that this morning our time of worship would be a sweet and fragrant offering to you, that your word would be declared, that you would meet us in this place and work powerfully in our lives. Prepare our hearts for this time. Clear out the distractions of this world. And draw our hearts to you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Your love has captured me, and your grace has set me free. Your life, the air I breathe, be glorified in me. Your love has captured me, and your grace has set me free. Your life, the air I breathe, be glorified in me. You set my feet to dancing, you set my heart on fire. In presence of a thousand kings, you are my one desire. And I stand before you now with trembling hands lifted high. Be glorified. Your love has captured me. Your grace has set me free. Your life, the air I breathe, be glorified in me. You set my feet a-dancing, you set my heart on fire. In the presence of a thousand kings, you are my one desire. And I stand before you now with trembling hands lifted high. Glorified in me be glorified. 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 You set my feet a dancing. You set my heart on fire in the presence of thousand kings, you are my one desire. I stand before you now with trembling hands lifted high. Be glorified. Falling from the clouds, a strange and lovely sound. I hear it in the thunder and the rain. It's ringing in the sky, the cannons in the night, the music of the universe plays. They're singing, you are holy, great and mighty, the moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are. Beautiful and free, a song of galaxies, reaching far beyond the Milky Way. Let's join in with the sound. Come on, let's sing it loud as the music of the universe plays. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are. All glory, honor, power is yours, amen. All glory, honor, power is yours, amen. All glory, honor, power is yours. Forever, amen. Sing all glory, honor, power is yours, amen. All glory, honor, power is yours, amen. All glory, honor, power is yours, forever, amen. We're singing, you are holy, great and mighty. The moon and the stars declare who you are. I'm so unworthy, but still you love me. Forever my heart will sing of how great you are.
Ushers can come forward and we'll take the offering. You can feel free to sit or stand. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. Oh, I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy rains. Unending love, amazing grace. Promise good to me, His word my hope secures. He will my shield and portion be as long as life endures. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. The earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns. Unending love, amazing grace. Earth shall soon dissolve like snow. The sun forbear to shine. But God, who called me here below, will be forever mine. Will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
We're going to be taking a break from our series today. Since school is starting up again and we have young people heading off to college and university, I thought it would be a good idea to take more of an apologetic approach to think about why we should believe the Bible and how we can answer critics. Full disclosure, much of my message today I stole from a man far more intelligent and godly than myself, so that's good news for all of you. Also, I've recycled this message as it's something that I have delivered previously, though of course I've made some changes and most of you haven't heard it before anyways. Now that all of my confessions are out of the way, let's get into it and explore an important question. Whether in college, in the workplace, or just around town, this question, I think, is one of the most important questions for a Christian to be able to answer. There are lots of important questions that we need to know how to answer, like, what must I do to be saved? But whenever we answer questions like that, there's another question that's going to be asked, or should be asked, and it deals directly with what authority we base our answers on. Ultimately, you're going to have to answer the question, why the Bible? Why do you choose to believe the Bible? Why the Bible instead of other religious or holy books? This question is of crucial importance because everything that we discuss as Christians is going to hinge off of the question, why do you believe the Bible? Dr. Bauckham shares a story of meeting with a group of college students on a campus and helping equip them to answer difficult questions they may encounter. He spoke with them about how there are many professors out there who are eager to engage in conversation with Christian students, especially early in the student's academic experience. There's typically a situation like this. There's a Christian student in class who disagrees with something the professor has said. The professor questions why, on what authority, to which the student replies, because the Bible says, at which point the professor begins to think that he has the student cornered. And unfortunately, most of the time, they do. So the professor asks, why the Bible, or why do you believe the Bible, or why should I believe the Bible? And at this point, I want to say that even professors in Christian institutions can undermine the accuracy and authority of the Bible, especially in our current culture, because it allows many comfortable, ear-tickling doctrines to enter the church. And it's happening in almost every Christian institution in North America. Now the student needs to give an answer. And unfortunately, as Christians, we are accustomed to giving some pretty bad answers. One of the worst answers that we use is, I believe the Bible because that's how I was raised. Folks, if you use this answer, please stop. Critics love to hear this answer, especially educated critics like professors, because it's so flawed. We are raised to believe all sorts of things that aren't true. My grandma used to say, stop eating so many popsicles or you'll turn into a popsicle. Good news, children, my grandma was lying. Or if you don't stop making that face, your face is going to be stuck like that. And though there's different things that could be said about my face, it isn't any of those faces she was referring to. We can learn the wrong things about vehicles, nature, academia, biology, sociology, every field of science, and pretty much everything. Plus, what do you do with all the other people in the world who are raised to be Buddhist, Muslim, Mormon, Jehovah's Witness, atheist, agnostic, witches, etc.? Those people were all raised that way. Does that mean that all of those things are true and they all have authority over life? You're going to be stuck in a slightly more mature version of my dad is bigger than your dad. This is how I was raised. Fine, this is how I was raised. Well, my parents raised me better than your parents raised you. That's not a solid ground. There's another common answer that we use, and because of our culture today and our elevation and worship of experience, this response is so popular. In this day and age, our culture believes that experience trumps all. It's all about your truth and what has happened to you and how you think about it. So when posed with the question, why do you believe the Bible, we respond with some variation of, well, I tried it and it changed my life. But what about the woman who saw nothing but hypocrisy in the church? And then she found a group of Buddhists who actually lived according to what they teach, and so she became Buddhist, and it changed her life. What about the Mormon who stopped smoking and drinking and swearing because they found the Book of Mormon? How about the person who's gone through Alcoholics Anonymous, and while working through the 12 steps, they came to the step about declaring a higher power, and they had to choose something. And so after they've found sobriety, they've had success, they can tell you all about how a flickering light at the neighbor's house saved them and changed them. So now, according to your logic, their neighbor's flickering light has as much power and authority as the Bible. Do you see the problem here? Now, at this point, some of you may be thinking, you just took away my two best answers, or my only two answers. I hope there's something more coming. And there is. About a week after Dr. Baucom had spoken with those students about how to answer this question, he received an email. A young lady that he had spoken with went to class in the following week, and she had that scenario play out. She objected to something that the professor said. He questioned her, and she brought up the Bible. She said that though he wasn't outwardly salivating, his eyes got big, he had a big grin, and he appeared confident. And then he asked, "Why do you believe the Bible?" The young lady told Dr. Baucom that she gave the professor the answer that he gave to her. "I choose to believe the Bible because it's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies and claim that their writings are divine rather than human in origin." To which the professor replied, "I'll have to get back to you." It's great to have a clear and concise answer like that. That's why things like catechisms, creeds, and confessions were created. But it's important to know where it came from. So please turn in your Bibles to 2 Peter chapter 1. Near the end of the Bible, 2 Peter chapter 1. Now, I just talked about why I believe the Bible, why we should believe the Bible, an answer that we can have. And then I told you to turn to somewhere in the Bible. At this point, you may be thinking, you can't use the Bible to prove the Bible. That's circular reasoning. And in basically every other area of life, I would agree with you. But you're wrong. If I tried to tell you why I believe the Bible using anything other than the Bible, I would be inconsistent and illogical. See, because I claim that the Bible is the highest ultimate authority in all of life and in all matters of life and godliness. So if I try to go to another source to prove the Bible, I am admitting that there are higher sources or alternative sources of authority, which there aren't. So I'm not using circular reasoning, I'm actually being logically consistent. If the Bible is the highest and ultimate authority in life, then everything else needs to be tested against it, even itself. And that's one of the amazing things about Scripture. It can be tested. Do it. Test it. Be like one of the countless people who's committed their entire lives to eradicating or disproving Scripture. You know what's happened to all of them? They've either died in unbelief, and their resources have been used to produce and distribute Bibles, or they've been converted. Every one of them. Every person who's committed their life to disproving Scripture, I mean really committed to testing it, they've either been so hard of heart that no amount of evidence will convince them, or they've been so lackluster in their testing that it's not really genuine, or they've come to the end of their testing and realized, I'm at a loss. This is truth. See, I'm not here this morning to defend the Bible. I'm here this morning to give an answer to the question, why do you believe the Bible? The Bible doesn't need me to defend it. It stands on its own. See, Charles Spurgeon said, I would no more defend the Bible than I would defend a lion. You know, you don't need to defend a lion. You just let him loose. He'll defend himself. I don't know how many of you have seen lions in person, but I've seen lions many times, and they certainly didn't need help, let alone my help, defending them. Let the word of God go. It will stand. It will defend itself. This morning, we're talking about how we can answer this question and why we should have confidence in a word that does stand. So with all of that said, please stand with me as we reverence the public reading of God's word. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 18. And in this passage, what we find is Peter answering critics, answering why you should believe the apostles' words, why you should believe the words that we have in Scripture. 16 to 21, for we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him from the majestic glory, this is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. We ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we are with him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time that we can look at a difficult question, an important question, and we can wrestle with how to answer. Thank you for faithful men of God who have committed their lives to equipping saints, to giving us short, memorable, winsome statements that can help us pack a lot of good truth in a memorable way, and we can be equipped to give answers that leave professors saying, let me get back to you. God, equip us this morning, your people. Equip us with an understanding of your word, with a love for your word. Teach us what it means to trust in you and to trust in your word. What it means that your word is the authority in all of life, and what it looks like to test everything against your word, even your word itself. Grant us understanding, illuminate our minds and hearts this morning, I pray, in your precious name. Amen. You may be seated. This text is where we get equipped to answer our question today. And so we're going to go through this response step by step, and there's going to be a lot of repetition so that this sinks into our minds, it helps us all remember it, so that we can have confidence when we're asked why we believe the Bible. And there are wallet-sized laminated cards on the table in the foyer, so please grab one or two of those. Awesome. Some people already grabbed two of those. They're just a helpful reminder, and if you can't remember this whole thing, you can have it on a card. You guys are fortunate. We're only going through this in one message. The youth went through this for like 10 weeks. What we're doing today? Maybe you think you're unfortunate because of that, but it's a reliable collection of historical documents. Say this with me. It's a reliable collection of historical documents. You guys didn't know there was going to be congregation participation this morning. Unlike other so-called holy books, the Bible is a collection. It was not written by one man claiming to hear from God. The Bible was written on three different continents, Asia, Africa, and Europe. The Bible was written in three different languages, Hebrew, Greek, and Aramaic. The Bible was written over a 1,500-year span, over 40 generations, written by 40 authors from every walk of life. kings, peasants, philosophers, soldiers, generals, historians, doctors, fishermen, poets, statesmen, scholars, etc. The Bible was written in times of war, times of peace, times of freedom, times of captivity, times of deliverance, times of suffering, and times of celebration. There are hundreds of different subjects and topics. The Bible also includes a wide range of writing styles: history, law, criminal, ritual, civil, ethical, and sanitary law, religious poetry, didactic treatises, lyric poetry, parable and allegory, biography, personal correspondence, personal memoirs and diaries, as well as biblically distinctive prophecy and apocalyptic writing. And all of these things work perfectly harmoniously together. Isn't that incredible? Think about just the people in this community. If we gave you an endless budget, we were going to pay your way, you didn't have to work anymore, your only focus was to come up with some kind of cohesive book, with a cohesive story drawing all the way through, telling a whole bunch of different stories from every different perspective with all different people. So you've got a logger, you've got a buncher, you've got a mechanic, you've got a school teacher, and you're all going to, at different times, without communicating with each other, write a cohesive, perfectly cohesive book that can stand up to any scrutiny. Now, if you were going to take an example and you were going to look at all of these authors over this 1,500-year span from all these different walks of life, you would have to conclude they would have to be in the top 1% of intelligence throughout all the world. They would have to have secret journals or diaries where they're writing all the background information to really make sure we're all on the same page, and even then it wouldn't be consistent. It would fall apart. This is an incredible miracle. People say that the fact that there were so many authors over such a big period of time, over multiple continents and multiple languages, is problematic for Christians. But when you look at the consistency and you put Scripture to the test, it's incredible. It should be confidence building, not confidence shattering. Three languages, three continents, 40 authors, hundreds of subjects, majority being controversial, 1,500 years, wide range of writing styles, and they all work perfectly, harmoniously together. It's incredible. Luke 1, 1 through 4 says, "Inasmuch as many have undertaken to compile a narrative of the things that have been accomplished among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and ministers of the word have delivered them to us, it seemed good to me, having followed all things closely for some time past, to write an orderly account for you, most excellent Theophilus, that you may have certainty concerning the things you have been taught." I don't know if you've realized this before, but Luke doesn't claim to be an eyewitness. He claims to be a historian that has studied and traced other eyewitness accounts. He openly says that he collected the information, that he studied it closely, in order to write an orderly account. And then in verse 4, he says that you may have certainty. He doesn't say so that you may have blind faith. He says certainty, that you may have certainty concerning the things you were taught. We need to understand that we have a reliable collection of historical documents. And Peter says in verse 16, "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." Folks, this isn't a fairy tale. It's not cleverly devised myths. No one is this intelligent or this organized, not even close. And they were eyewitnesses. So say this with me: it's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses. John 1:1 says, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life." They were eyewitnesses. They heard with their own ears, saw with their own eyes, and touched with their own hands. Verses 2 and 3 continue to describe what they have seen and heard and touched. We have the Old and the New Testament written by eyewitnesses of events that they experienced, what they saw and touched and heard, and they lived during the time of other eyewitnesses. That's really important. One of the reasons that this is so important is because the scriptures were written in times when other eyewitnesses were alive and would have been able to argue against anything false that was said. This also adds credibility because anything that would be considered incorrect would have been contested and amended. So when you make a claim, it needs to be falsifiable or verifiable. People need to be able to test it, to speak against it, to evaluate it. The New Testament documents were written and distributed in a time where other eyewitnesses were still alive. They had the chance to verify. They had the chance to falsify. That is confidence instilling. 1 Corinthians 15, 1-8 says, "Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, and by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas," or Peter, "then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me." So stop for a second and do the math. At the time of 1 Corinthians being written, there are at the very least 301 eyewitnesses to the resurrection still alive. At the very least. Even secular psychologists say that Jesus appearing to all of these witnesses being a lie or some form of mass psychosis or some other phenomena would seemingly be an even greater miracle than rising from the dead. So it's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. Say that with me. It's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. Did you know that there have been over 25,000 archaeological digs related directly to the Bible? Never have any of the findings contradicted the Bible, though some have claimed and been disproven, often with very tiny retractions printed near the end of journals. Most of the archaeological sites actually confirm and affirm the biblical records. In fact, there are secular historians and archaeologists that have admitted they refer to the Bible when doing research because the Bible has been proven to be the most historically accurate book ever written. Now, they don't include any of that in their research documentation because they'll lose all their funding, but they've admitted on camera with blacked-out faces and distorted voices that they go to the Bible to figure out how they're going to do their research. And then once they've got their data, they write it all up as if they had never consulted Scripture. Now, people make the claim, and I'm sure many of you have heard it, that the Bible we have now is actually written much later than any originals and long after any of the biblical characters were around. And then we also get told that Constantine came along, he ordered a ton of changes to be made, and they messed with all the manuscripts, and so we can't trust the Bible that we have today. How many of you have heard some of that before? They came, they changed a bunch of stuff, they've edited all this, we can't really trust it. People also argue that the Bible can't be trusted because it's been translated so many times. How many of you have heard that? It's been translated way too many times. You can't possibly trust this. Have you ever heard of the telephone game? The people that make this claim are either ignorant, evil, or both. That may sound harsh, but it's true. They argue that it's like playing the telephone game where I tell someone something, they tell the next person, and so on and so forth until a message gets to person number 10 or person number 100, and it's nothing like the original message. But it's an incredibly flawed thought. That is not how Bible translation works. If you were going to try use the telephone game picture, it would be more like me telling person one a message, and then me going and telling person two the same message, and then going to number three with the same message, and so on until I have personally told every single person the exact same message. And then all of those people would get checked for their accuracy of the message that they have, and so there's been no gain or loss of data. When the Bible's translated, they go back to all of the earliest manuscripts, and they translate based on the original Greek, Hebrew, and Aramaic texts. So if you've heard things like, we now have all these translations today, NIV, KJV, ESV, the list goes on, there's lots of acronyms. And say the ESV, which was made around 2000, I think, it's not like they went to the most recent English translation and then just kind of spruced it up to try and make this new English translation. When the ESV was created, they went back to the Hebrew, the Greek, and the Aramaic. They go back to the original manuscripts. Now, not every translation does that, and so we do have problems with translations, but that's a different issue than if we can trust Scripture. In fact, if you want to learn Hebrew and Greek, you can go to the originals, and you can read them in their original language. Thankfully, you don't have to do that today because there's so many resources, but we have access. Again, we can test it. As well, originally when they were making copies of Scripture, the copyist techniques that they used were incredibly stringent and meticulous. I don't know if any of you have ever looked into it, but they would count the syllables, they would count the structure, they would count how many words or symbols appear on a page, that not just reading through like proofreading like we do. They were so meticulous. In the Greek, they would count the uppercase and the lowercase letters. They would make sure everything was in the right place. They were so meticulous. It's actually incredible. Go research that. But we do have a problem. Maybe this is going to be a blow to your faith, but we don't actually have any of the original manuscripts. Nobody looks super shocked. Due to the material that was used to create them, we don't have original manuscripts yet. Maybe we'll find some. But we do have documents dating back as early as AD 120. We can put our hands on documents that were created within 20 to 25 years of the originals. How many manuscripts do we have? Of just the New Testament alone, we have over 6,000 manuscripts or portions of manuscripts, Greek. If you include other language translations, we have about 26,000 manuscripts or portions of manuscripts of just the New Testament. So keep in mind, this is with multiple emperors, rulers, kings, etc., throughout history, destroying all the Bibles, all the copies of Scripture that they could find, digging up floorboards, destroying all of it. We still have this many old original manuscripts. But if this doesn't sound too impressive, it's probably because you don't specialize in ancient literature. That's okay. I forgive you. I'm not interested in that either, except for this. If you look at Plato's Tetralogies, we have just over 200 manuscripts. That's the most recent number I could find. The earliest one is dated 1,300 years after Plato's original writing. Of Julius Caesar's Gallic Wars, we have approximately 250 manuscripts and around 950 years after the original writing. The best ancient writing that we can look to as far as manuscripts go is Homer's Iliad. There are around 1,700 manuscripts now. They're mostly portions of manuscripts, though. And the earliest credibly dated manuscript is nearly 2,000 years from the original, though some argue that there is a copy dated as close as 400 years, but that really hasn't been authenticated. No ancient writing comes even close to the Bible. None of those ancient writings had entire nations trying to destroy them. And funny enough, academia and our culture today doesn't question the validity of those writings. Nothing comes close to the Bible. Over 6,000 Greek New Testament manuscripts or portions, with the earliest ones dated 25 years or less from the original text. The people who wrote them were still alive when these copies were written. Then there's this conspiracy that some overzealous monks went and changed all the manuscripts of the New Testament. So this comes back to Constantine, when you've heard that Constantine came and changed everything. This is fairy tale. For them to have had to do that, they would have had to go and find all 6,000 manuscripts. At that time, there would have been many, many more. Change all the Greek, if they're doing the Old Testament, all the Hebrew, and as well with the New Testament, all the Aramaic manuscripts. Lie consistently and perfectly in all of them, in three different languages. Don't show any ink work or evidence of tampering. Then replace all the manuscripts and never tell anyone what they did. Then, when all the people groups started getting the scriptures, language translations had to be made, and the scriptures were translated into Syriac, Coptic, and Latin. So there weren't just Greek and Aramaic manuscripts, there were Syriac, Coptic, and Latin manuscripts. So these overzealous lying priests would have had to locate all of the thousands of manuscripts written in Syriac, Coptic, and Latin, and lie perfectly and consistently in all of those, in those languages, not tell anyone, not show any ink work or evidence of tampering, and return all of those manuscripts to where they belong. And to accomplish this, those priests would have had to live somewhere in the hundreds of years range, be total linguistic experts in Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic, Latin, Coptic, and Syriac. It didn't happen, folks. Plus, all of that aside, the early church fathers had this annoying habit where they depended so passionately upon the scriptures that if you were to take just the sermons, journals, and notes of the early church fathers, you would be able to completely and perfectly build the entire New Testament except for 11 verses. And some people argue less than that. That's incredible. People, we have a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. If we look at verses 17 and 18 of our text in 2 Peter, we read, "For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased,' we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain." So say this with me. We have a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events. So the Bible is not just a historically accurate collection of eyewitness reports, but it is a collection of supernatural events. In verse 19, Peter says, "And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts." We don't have time to go through this verse in detail, but it's this beautiful thing. He's talking about prophecy, the foretelling of Christ coming, and we see this odd statement about a lamp shining and the day dawning. And in especially that time, when you were out in the dark, if you saw a lamp shining in the distance, you paid attention to it. You watched it. You needed to know if it was friend or foe, how close it was. You eagerly paid attention to that light. Christ is our light. And so we're called to eagerly pay attention to him until the day dawns and the morning star rises in our hearts, until God does that miraculous work of conversion in our lives. That's a miracle, and it's something that was prophesied. These men claimed that Jesus saved people. He healed the sick. He made the blind see. He caused the lame to walk. He walked on water. He died and rose again 3 days later. These are not just the writings of a religious community trying to pass down rules, regulations, or stories. Not only are there supernatural events that are recorded, but they are supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies. Professor Peter Stoner, author of Science Speaks, stated, him and his team, that the probability of just 8 particular prophecies being fulfilled in one person is 1 in 10 to the 17th power. That's that number there. Emile Borel, the pioneer of probability theory, determined that anything greater than 1 in 10 to the 50th power was mathematically equal to impossible. So the professor and his team went on to consider just 48 of the biblical prophecies about Jesus. They found that the chance of any one man fulfilling just 48 of the prophecies is 1 in 10 to the 157th power. That's that number there. This is so far beyond what is considered mathematically impossible, and that's only for fulfilling 48 prophecies. Now again, if that doesn't sound super impressive, or 48 sounds like a big number, perhaps you've never gone and read through the Old Testament prophecies that are fulfilled perfectly and completely by Jesus Christ. Did you know that there are over 300 detailed prophecies that point to Jesus? There's some argument on exactly the number depending on how you group some prophecies together, but I have a list on my computer of 355 prophecies fulfilled by Christ. Go home and read Isaiah 53. Read of Jesus' crucifixion, and then go back and read Psalm 22, literally titled, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. My God, why have you forsaken me? And imagine what the Jews at that time, who had so much scripture committed to memory, would have thought as Jesus hung on the cross and quoted and brought the remembrance back to just one of these prophecies. So say this with me. It's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies. Let's go to the last two verses of our text, 20 and 21. Knowing this, first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. So we have a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that take place in fulfillment of specific prophecies, and they claim that their writings are divine rather than human in origin. We have 66 books, 1,189 chapters, over 31,000 verses, 40 authors, 1,500 years, 3 continents, 3 languages, every walk of life, every joy and sorrow of life, every hardship and every celebration of life working perfectly, harmoniously together. Because ultimately, the Bible was not written by men. The Bible is a collection of divine writings by men being used and carried along by the Holy Spirit of God, just as Peter says. Dear people, the reason that we can trust the Bible and stand on it above all else is because we know where it came from. The Bible is the living word of the living God, the one who created the entire world and all things in it, the one who sustains all things, the one who knit us together in our mother's wombs, the one who created us and sent his son to die for us and adopted us and loves us. He is the author. He can be trusted. He does not lie. He does not change. His word holds up. Test it. There's no greater authority in this world than the word of God that he has given us. So let us be a people who study God's word and know it and hide it in our hearts. A people who test everything in life against the only authority we can really trust in. In a world, in a time where there is no truth, let's go back to the only truth that we can depend on. Let us be a people who allow God's word to influence every single area of our lives, as Caleb read earlier this morning in Psalm 119, 9 through 16. When people ask us why we believe the Bible, let's be prepared with an answer. Say this with me. I choose to believe the Bible because it's a reliable collection of historical documents written by eyewitnesses during the lifetime of other eyewitnesses. They report supernatural events that took place in fulfillment of specific prophecies and claim that their writings are divine rather than human in origin. And you know what? If that's not enough, I tried it and it changed my life. Let's pray. Father, thank you that your word is trustworthy, that we've only hardly scratched the surface on the reliability and trustworthiness of Scripture. God, I pray that you would work in each one of us, that you would draw us closer to you, closer to your word, that you would give us a longing to hear from you, to read what you have written for us, to apply it to our lives, to test everything against it, the perfect measuring rod, the perfect canon for life. Thank you, Lord, for such a precious gift. Don't let us take it for granted. Don't let us undermine it. Don't let us get tricked and confused by fancy-sounding people with special titles before their names that hate you and love to see us trip and fall. Give us wisdom and understanding. Convict us of our lack of love for you and your word, for our lack of study. Forgive us, your people, for taking this precious gift for granted, a gift that so many in the world cling to and die for, to have even for a few moments. Let us go home and brush the dust off our Bibles, to read them together as families, to read them aloud, and to celebrate how amazing your word is. Give us confidence, Lord. Make us a confident people, a risen army for you, we pray. In the name, by the precious power and the blood of Jesus Christ, our only hope, our Lord and Savior, the Word in the flesh. Amen.
And stand and sing for the song. I love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. Moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire and darkest nights. You are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. And I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful.
All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. My life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Your goodness. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I'm surrendered now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. Oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Well, this is an exciting moment. Baptism is an expression, it's an outward symbol of an inward change, an inward work of God in the life of somebody. And today that somebody is Anthony. And I'm excited that he's here. You may not know him. That's okay. He's going to give you a chance to know him.
I'm Anthony Sensenig, 19 years old. Was raised in the conservative Mennonite circle. Was converted at 16 years old. And the tradition in that Mennonite culture is that you get baptized about a year afterwards. Unfortunately, I had some personal issues and some attitude problems, and never went ahead with it. And when I moved back from Ontario, started attending another church, and didn't really find what I was looking for. And then I started live streaming here, and really inspired me. And it's a great environment for spiritual growth, I believe. And just want to thank you all for your sincerity. Yeah, that's it.
So we have the opportunity to celebrate together as a church. We're celebrating the work that God has done in Anthony's life and his step forward as a profession of faith and as obedience to God. So Anthony, do you believe in the one true God that exists in three distinct persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit?
I do.
Do you believe that apart from the work of God, you are naturally sinful, and do you publicly repent and profess your need of a Savior?
Yes, I do.
Do you believe that Jesus Christ died in your place so that you could receive the salvation of God?
I do.
Have you believed in Jesus Christ alone for your salvation and experienced His redeeming work in your life? Do you firmly resolve to live a Christian life and to obey and serve Jesus as your King for the rest of your life?
I do.
All right. Anthony, based upon your public profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Buried with Christ and raised in newness of life.
Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace? This hour are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? When the bridegroom comes, will your robes be white? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Will your soul be ready for the mansions bright? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? There's a fountain flowing unclean. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
I'll leave you this morning. Acquainted with the sacred writings, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that the man and woman of God may be complete, equipped for every good work. Go in peace. Come and say hi to Anthony and join us downstairs for fellowship. Thank you.